and guided me through. And I begin to praise you with all that's in me, raising my hands up.
Hi, this is Pastor Drew from Hope Community Church. Hey, listen, I'm so excited about the Word of God. Grab your Bibles, grab your notepads, grab your pens. Get ready for a great teaching right out of the Word of God. I know you're going to enjoy this, so get ready.
So we have this technology, and it's really cool, and we want to start to implement it. So not only can you follow me up on the screen, researchers have figured out that you'll remember more of what you write down. So this isn't an excuse not to write things down, okay? But it's really important. Researcher also found out that if you will, that your retention rate will go up if you write things down. But researchers have also found out that your retention goes through the roof if you will review what you wrote down within 24 hours. So it's really important that we want to give you a tool to have my notes in a tangible thing. There are people sometimes, they'll say, I'll want something, and they'll say, oh, I'll say, just text it to me. You know why I want it text to me? Because now it's boom, it's on a computer. Now I have it. I don't have it on some piece of paper that's going to get lost. I have it on my phone. So if you don't know what we're talking about, there's these things, they're called smartphones. And they have these other things, they're called apps. And you can get this app, and it's the Bible. So you can, on your phone, go to Genesis, you can go to James, you can go to James chapter 3, you can go, and you can do all that. It's real simple. And but now, if you have that Bible app, you can very simply have my notes. Okay. How many think that would be a benefit for them? Raise your hand if you think, man, that would be cool. And that's not all of us, you know what I mean? Some of us are very old school, and that's okay. That's okay. But some of us aren't old school, and it's helpful. Again, I'm not trying to get you to raise your hand. I'm just trying to see how many of you will think, Tamara, come up here because I want you to see this. Wow, you look very pretty today, honey. How many of you think that would help you? Raise your hand real high so we can see. Okay, you got that?
To have the
Bible app. Right, keep your hand up. Okay.
Nice.
Yeah, okay, good. So we'll have that every Sunday and Wednesday. If you didn't make sense out of this, just go see somebody like 25 or younger and they'll help you, okay? Okay, well, then you, well, actually, some of you older people are very tech savvy, so, but not all of us, okay? All right, praise God. Aren't you glad we have a church and we got young people in our church? No, come on, aren't you glad we got a church and we got young people in the church? Listen, I watch, and I praise God for everyone, amen. I thank God for everyone, but let me tell you what. There's a purposefulness that Tamara and I, you know what, it's part of the calling in our life. Part of the calling in this church is to be a multicultural church. Amen? Somebody says, your church looks like it. You got a Skittles church. You know what I mean? What's a Skittles church? Skittles church is all kind of different colors, right? Right? Okay. So, but we also, one of our calling is to be a multicultural. Our calling also is to be multi-generational. Come on, you need to shout on this one. I say you need to shout on this one. Listen, there's churches that you go in, and I'm just telling you the truth, everyone's over 50 in their church. I'm not lying. There's churches and the pastor will be the only one under 40 in the whole church. It's absolutely true. And I'm not saying that they don't have an intentionality. I'm just saying You got to work hard at this. You got to be on purpose. You got to be non-selfish. First room, when we got here, first room that we worked on was not my office. And trust me, my office needed work. The first room that we worked on was the children's room. And listen, I'm not saying the kids are more important than you guys, because we don't have that mentality. But we also don't have the mentality that you're more important than them. Listen, you're not more important than him, and he's not more important than you. And I know you guys know that, but I'm using you for an example. We're all important. But the church has got to see it that way, because it very is easy for senior pastors to get caught up in the adult ministry. It just is. And so Tamara and I have always been very purposeful to make sure that we are cognizant of not just the adult ministry. All right. So use that app. We'll play that several times. If you haven't need any help, you know what? Joel, Pastor Vegas, other younger people can help you. You know what? And that'll be a blessing. Okay. So, okay. You ready to learn some stuff? You got some tough skin today? You gonna need some tough skin? I remember listening to an evangelist, and she said this. She said, in the body of Christ, we got way too many puff Christians. We got people who will leave the church over the stupidest reasons. Yeah, I got real quiet there. And what's all that? What is that about? Let me tell you what that's about. That's about a puff Christian. You know how much nutritional value a cheese puff has? Exactly. No, it's -5. Okay. Well, how many know there's some things? You know what? Your flesh will tolerate stuff that you shouldn't tolerate. Here, tweet that. Your flesh will tolerate things that you shouldn't tolerate. What I want to talk to you today is about being tough, being strong, about being strong and staying strong. And I'm not a doom gloom kind of guy, but here's what I sense there's some tough times coming upon us, and what I want to teach you is how we are going to flourish. Everybody say flourish. I didn't say just survive. See, can I tell you what the truth? We've got to get this just survive mentality out of our hearts, out of our minds. We've got to stop thinking that God wants to just provide for us just enough to survive. Get rid of that thinking. Start to understand that's not your calling. Your calling is to thrive. Your calling is to be such a blessing that you would be able to bless others in all kinds of ways. See, I've taught you this to you before. God doesn't want a family. He wants a big family. And so what God wants is he wants blessings to come to his family in order that it's the example is in Israel. You know one of the reasons why God selected Israel is because they were so small. Same mentality as he continued to with Gideon. Continue to not reinforce, not recruit people to the army, but to whittle it down to smaller amount. Why? Because when they had the victory, he wanted to be said that it was God who caused the victory. See, God is looking to do a supernatural thing on this earth. And in order to do it, you've got to toughen up and you've got to recognize, you've got to start to open up your thinking and say, wait, wait, wait. God doesn't just want to bless me that me and my family would be blessed. God wants to bless me in order that I could be a funnel of blessings to other people. But can I tell you what? To do that, God's got to toughen you up, and he's got to toughen me up, and we've got to start to understand that there's some things that we're called to do that God wants to make us tough. So when the storm comes, we're going to be fine. And others whose houses are crashing all over the place, some of these people who think they're saved, they think they're Christians, but they're not. And they're going to look around. They're going to say, man, what's going on? I don't understand. And I want to teach you. Because we've got to be prepared for what God wants to do in our lives. God is going to do something on this earth that's coming up. We're seeing it happening. And now is not the time to tuck and run. Now is the time to be bold. Now is the time to do great, great things in the kingdom of God. And we're not going to do it. We're not going to do it without seeing what God says in his word. Can I show you a total key for you being strong in the Lord? Can I show it to you? You haven't convinced me yet. Can I show it to you? Okay, well, here's what I'm asking. Can I show it to you, and can you take it? That's what I want to know this morning. Can you take it this morning? Oh, yeah, show it to me, Pastor. As long as it's, you know, as long as the needle's not too long. That's why, you know what? I want the medicine, but you know what? Make sure it tastes like chocolate. You know what I mean? Amen? You don't preach, Pastor, but just don't preach too long. Amen? No, really. Because, you know what, I got an appointment at a certain time. You know, I got to get out of here. You know what I mean? You know, some, Pastor, make sure it's not too hot in here. Make sure the seats are comfortable. Make sure praise isn't too long. Make sure, you know what, make sure you don't talk about money. Even though it's my responsibility to build the kingdom of God. But don't talk about that, Pastor. See, my question is, before we start, am I still smiling? My question for you is this, can you take it? Or do you only want, you know what, do you only want it if it's given to you in a, you know, are you ready are you easily offended? Now are you still ready for it? Some of you are like, I said, are you still ready for it?
Yeah.
See, I noticed it didn't get it. It wasn't as expressive as the first time. Are you still ready for it?
Yeah.
You know what Paul says? Paul says he beats his body. Turn to Hebrews chapter 10. Hebrews chapter 10, and I'm gonna turn to a verse that's very, very familiar, but I want you to learn some stuff here. Hebrews chapter 10. Hebrews chapter 10. And let's start, guys in the back, I know we were going to start on verse 23, but I want to go back up to verse 22. Guys, can you do that? Go back up to verse 22. Look what it says. Let us draw near with a true heart, a full assurance of faith. Now, what's the first word there?
Let.
Come on, guys. What's the first word there?
Let.
Everybody say let.
Let.
What is what? Let is an indication that it's not automatic. You have to choose to do this. You have to let it happen. It's up to you. It's like you're the gate, and you can either keep the gate closed or you can open up the gate. It's up to you. Let us draw near with a true heart of full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled from an evil consciousness. Remember, this morning we were already talking about this evil consciousness, and our bodies washed with a pure word. Now, can I tell you what that's not talking about? It's not saying that when you take a shower, you need to use some purified water. It's not talking about that. Remember, the Bible says that rivers of life will flow out of you. Everybody say rivers of life. See, what's that? That's the word. The word is likened. It's one of the metaphors that the Bible used to the word is water. So God wants us to be sprinkled with this freshness of God's word. He wants our mind washed by the word. And our bodies need to be, not just our minds, but our whole bodies need to be cleansed by the word of God. And we need to let that happen. Now, this is very important because I'm going to put this together in context. Because God's going to tell us something really, really important. And in our cool cat mentality of 2015, Christianity in America 2015, watch this. We sit here and say, yeah, but Pastor, it's not a big deal whether I come to church or not. Let's not get legalistic on this. But what we haven't done is What we haven't done is sometimes look at the practicality in the Word of God and allow that to speak to us and really minister to us what the Bible says. Are you ready to see this? Look at verse 23. Let us hold fast to the confession of our hope without wavering. Everybody say without wavering. My first point, and write this down. Here's my first point. Guys, can you go to my first point? Number one, hold fast to the confession of our hope without wavering. Hold fast. Everybody say this. Hold fast to the confession of our hope, real loud, without wavering. Real loud, without wavering. Without wavering. Let us, first word again, let. You've got to make a decision that the things that the Holy Spirit has spoken to you, the dreams, how many of God has dreams for you that he wants to, that he's spoken in your life, that, you know what, and over a period of time, we're going to get to it in a minute, the reasons why we've abandoned these things, but we've got to stay true to what God has promised us and not let circumstance get us off of our confession. Amen. 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 Yeah, but I've been believing for healing for this long, and I said, whoa, whoa, whoa. Yeah, but I, and we, there's these circumstances that come up, and we back off our confession. The Bible says, it's up to you to hold fast. Don't let go of your confession of hope. Don't let go of your confession of hope. Don't let go of your confession of hope. Don't start, you know what? Don't start singing a new song. Three things real quick, things that get you off. Number one, what you see. We don't walk by sight. We walk by faith. Amen? And there's things that we can see, and you know what? And we say, oh, see, it's like this. It's always been like that. See, it's like this. It doesn't make any difference. The sea was closed. But God separated the sea, did he not? Lazarus was dead. But God restored him, did he not? See, God is a God of changing things how they look. Do not, and let me tell you what, if you get your eyes on what you see, it's going to change your confession. Most people say what they see. And what we need to do is we need to say what we see in the Word of God. Amen? Number two, what people say. We allow other people to infect us and say, well, I don't think. I love what Tamara said this morning. We have Facebook and we got, I got 48 followers, or I got 148 followers, or I got 368 followers. Well, who cares how many followers you got? What I want to know is how many followers you got that are speaking the word into your life. Amen. I'd rather have three real friends who know God's word than 148 friends that don't know, what they're talking about half the time. And what are they doing? They're just talking what they see. And so watch what this happens. So all it becomes is this reoccurring, this self-fulfilled prophecy of what you see. And so you see it, go, well, this is how it is. That's how it is. And that's what they see. And nothing changes. Can I tell you what? You have been put on this earth to change situations in your family, in your city, in your life, in your church, in places, in your school. That's your role. And by simply looking at how it's been with your eyes and listening to all your friends, and what do they see? All they see is what they see, and so they say what they see, and nothing changes. And God says, stop it. You've got to recognize, you've got to hold fast and say, I'm not moved. I don't care what I see. I don't care what they say. Number three, the third thing, that the time that it takes to see it come to pass, whatever it is. The Bible says that how do we obtain the promises of God? Through faith and patience. See, God's timing, yes, but you've got to proclaim, you've got to not stop, you've got to say, this is how it's going to be, and I tell you what, and I'm not changing, I don't care what you say, I don't care what you see, I don't care what I see, I'm just not changing. I know what God has said, and I know what he's going to do, and I don't care if it takes a month, I don't care if it takes a week, I don't care if it takes a year, I'm just not changing. Come on, somebody. I'm just not going to change. And I'm not going to allow you to convince me to say that's what's going to happen. It ain't going to happen. Amen? Amen. It ain't going to. Listen, what I see, God spoke to me. I see it in the Word of God. That's what's going to happen. Let God be true and every man a liar. You got to hold fast to your confession of faith. I told the men on Thursday night, I'm just tired of particularly puff men. You know what I mean? No, men, we need to stand up and let our confession not change. Say, no. My confession not changing. I'm not moved by what I see. I'm not moved by what I hear. I'm not moved by a period of time that it hasn't changed. That's just going to make, you know what? My dad used to teach me, the bigger they are, the harder they fall. Amen? Amen? Number two, you see it in verse 25. Look what it says. Not forsaking the assembling of ourselves together. Now, this is really the point of today. How are you going to survive calamities? Well, the Bible tells us how we're going to survive the calamities. Not forsaking the gathering of the brethren. See, we've got to take this mentality of, well, I show up to church when it's convenient for me. We've got to take that mentality and understand that is not a biblical mentality. That is unbiblical. How many know there's things that you'll do and there's consequences for your action? Now, I'm getting way ahead of myself, but I'm telling you, this is what the Bible says. Look at it. Verse 23. Guys in the back, follow me. Verse 23. Let us hold fast to the confession of our hope without wavering, for he who promised is faithful. Listen, God is faithful. Yes, come on, all You don't have to back off. God will be faithful. But what you have to do is stay with your confession. Stay with what you say. Stay with what you know. Don't allow these circumstances to mess you up. Verse 24, and let us consider one another in order to stir up love and the good works. We'll talk about that in a minute. Not forsaking the assembling of ourselves together. Now look at this. As is the manner of some. Oh. Have you ever noticed some Christians, you see the manifestation of the blessings of God in their life? Come on, are y'all here? You notice you can see some Christians and there's manifestations of the blessings of God in their life. If you've seen that, raise your hand. Say, Pastor, I know what you're saying is true. Come on, say it. Say, Pastor, I know what you're saying is true. Come on, say it. I know what you're saying is true. Okay. How many of you know that there's some people and you don't see the manifestations of blessings in their life? Raise your hand and say, Pastor, that's true too. And what we want to say is we want to say, oh, that's just coincidental. They're just, see, some people, we even have the world mentality on our lips. Oh, some people are luckier than other people. I called a Christian organization lately, just recently, and I needed some information, and they got me in charge of somebody, and before they got off there, they said, I'm not lying, here's what they said, well, good luck with that. I want to say, are you saved? I didn't say that. Listen, let me tell you what. As is the manner of some. Everybody say, as is the manner of some. Okay. My second point, not forsaking. You want to survive? Here's what you need to do. Not forsaking the assembling of yourself together. That's what you have to do. And understand, some are consistent in church and some are not. Now, we want to say in our lack of understanding of the Word of God. See, listen, I didn't get this out of some textbook. This is what God says. Not forsaking the assembly of ourselves together. We want to say, oh, it's, you know, Pastor, you know, I can go, you know, certainly I can miss. Let's not be legalistic. I can go to the swap meet if I want. It's no big deal. I'm here most of the time. I don't have to come Sunday and Wednesdays. You know what? Yada, yada. And we come up with all the excuses in the world. But God, it doesn't change. God says, listen, don't forsake the gathering, brethren. And some do it and some don't. Some are faithful and some are not. That's the truth. That's what it says, as the manner of some. What's that mean? He means some people don't. And later on, I'm going to show you these consequences to the people who don't. And I'm telling you what, when I read this, I'm just telling you what, it's freaky. And people will say, Pastor, that's ridiculous. That's false doctrine. Well, listen, then you argue with the writer of Hebrews. Don't argue with me. Argue with Hebrews. Argue with the writer of Hebrews. Argue with the Holy Spirit. Because the Holy Spirit says there's these consequences that come as we just decide, well, Pastor, I'm just going to do, you know what? Because I'm under grace, we just get to do whatever we want to do. And if you're saying we always got to come to church, then that's the law. And you're putting us under bondage. Well, again, argue with Hebrews. You can call it whatever you want. I've noticed as soon as, oh my goodness. Give me this camera right over here. You on? Are you on? Okay. I've noticed that as soon as someone doesn't want to do something that's in the New Testament, you know what they say? They say, that's law. You can text that one. You can tweet that one too. Tweet! Listen, as soon as someone feels like they don't want to do it anymore, then they'll say, well, that's law. Can I tell you what? Notice, this is the New Testament. This isn't an Old Testament. This is New Testament. The Bible says, don't forsake the gathering of the brethren. But we are living in a place that we don't understand. We're such in rebellion, we don't understand. There is someone who commands us. His name is God. This is his word. This is his will. His will is that you don't forsake the gathering brethren. Now listen, before you take it in the negative, let me take it in the positive, because if you won't do that, if you'll do that, if you will be here consistently Sunday and Wednesday, there's going to be a blessing that will come to you. I'm going to show you what it is. But notice, I'm not being negative. Notice, the word of God tells you there's a consequence if you don't.
Oh, come on, there it is.
There's this mentality out there, Pastor, just be positive. Just be positive. Just be positive. Just be positive. That's all we need. Well, okay, then what in the world? Then how come is it negative to point out what the Bible says? No. Is it negative to tell your kids don't play in the street? Well, Pastor, you shouldn't be a negative parent. No, you should be responsible. And there's consequences for our actions. Are you learning something? So what happens when we come together? Point three. Something happens when we come together. Have you ever come and you're just like, oh man, I'm just melancholy. You're just like, you know, you just feel like, you just, you know, you're having a Eeyore day. You know what I mean? You're having an Eeyore day. And then you come in and you hear the word of God and you just hear the preaching. And all of a sudden you think, it ain't that bad, man. I got this. We got this. Somebody? Come on, somebody. I said, somebody? Listen, what's happening? Faith comes through hearing. You know where that portion of scripture is? It's in Romans, and the same portion of scripture, it says, how are they going to hear without a preacher? And how is that preacher going to preach unless you send him? Amen. What we have to do is we have to recognize there's a benefit. When we come together, faith comes and we encourage each other. In two areas, the Bible says, look at it. It's in verse 24. And let us consider one another in order to stir up love and good works. Hey, let me ask you spouses that are married. You ever get ticked off at your spouse? Say, Pastor, I don't know. Should I tell the truth or should I? Because I'm thinking I should tell the truth, but I don't know if I want to raise my hand. Okay. Just let's, you know, we'll plead the fifth on that one, okay? Okay. So let me just say this. But is there times, have you ever come to church and you're just irritated with your spouse and something that I say, something that Tamara says, something that happens in praise and worship, and all of a sudden you feel like, man, I've just been a jerk. Am I the only one? See, what happened? Here's what happened. We stirred up love. That's what happened. We stirred up love. That's what happens in the Word of God. Because the Word of God, God is love. And you can't teach the Word of God that love's not stirred up. You ever come in and you just felt like, man, I you know what? After I tithe, I don't got hardly enough. You know, I barely got enough for lunch. And all of a sudden you notice, and all of a sudden you're buying somebody else lunch. Like, where'd that come from? Here's where it came from. We stirred up love. Can I tell you what? Listen to me very, very carefully. Love, the Bible, see, the main thing you need to do is walk in love, because love never fails. See, this is listen, don't take this wrong. I'm telling you what, if you don't start doing this stuff, the storm's going to come and you're going to get wiped out. Love, there's this protection that God has for us, and part of that protection is hanging out in church. Two things get stirred up. One, love gets stirred up, and the other is good works. How many know that however you measure it out, that's how it's going to be measured back to you. I wish I had a. You ever see those real little spoons? Tamara, what do they use those spoons? Is that just a decorating spoon, or do they use those for something? Real little spoon. I mean, the spoon just little. Yeah. You ever see one? Okay, whatever. Okay, a little sugar. I don't. When I use sugar, I want a big sugar spoon. Amen. But anyway, you see, listen, love you guys. Listen, again, give me this camera. Am I smiling? Okay. Some of you, the problem is your good work spoon is so small that there's such a small return. And it doesn't have to do with God not loving you. It doesn't have to do with God not blessing you. It has everything to do with your spoon is way too small. Because the Bible says with the measure that you measure it out, that's the measure it's going to be come back to you. So you come to church and we start talking about love. We start talking about serving. We start talking about how much God has loved you. And it stirs up in you. All of a sudden, you don't have a small spoon. All of a sudden, you're reaching in your purse, figuratively, and you're bringing one of those big scoopers, one of those big ice scoopers. Like, man. And all of a sudden, you're stirred up to do something for somebody else. Now, listen, let me tell you why that's so great. Because as we see this stuff going on, as we see the days approaching, we need to get rid of our little spoons. Where does that happen? It happens. Okay, can I share one more thing with you? Okay, I'm just going to rock some of your boats. Okay. But look at it. It's in the text. Look at verse. Okay, so let's take it from 23. Let us hold fast to the confession of our hope without wavering, for he whose promise is faithful. And let us consider one another in order to stir up good works, not forsaking the assembling of ourselves together, as is the manner of some. See, some people do it, some people don't. But exhorting one another. Exhorting just means encouraging one another. Exhorting one another, and so much the more as we see the day approaching. See, listen to me. As you see the circumstances, and most of us live our life according to circumstances. So as you see those circumstances getting more negative, we need to hang out together and encourage each other more. That's what he's saying. Because one of the number one things that Satan tries to use is discouragement. Now watch this. Now here's what's going to freak some of you out. I didn't write this. Are you ready for this? For if we sin willfully, after we have received the knowledge of the truth, there no longer remains a sacrifice for sin. Pastor, what's he saying there? Here's what he's saying. It's really, 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 really important that you don't miss church. See, did you hear what he said? Look at it. For if we sin, you know what he's calling this? He's calling people who forsake the gathering of the brethren for whatever reason. Everybody say for whatever reason. Whatever. Okay. And certainly I'm not talking about, passed away in the family. I'm not talking about stuff like that. But we come up with the flimsiest reasons why we can justify. And here's what he's saying. He's saying he calls that a sin. Puff, puff Christians, we don't even call not coming to church a sin anymore. We just say, Pastor, I was busy. And we expect that it, and matter of fact, what we do, if the pastor would say, no, that's a sin, you'd go, what? Man, I started looking for a new church. Pastor's getting legalistic on me. No, pastor's not getting legalistic on you. Pastor's getting Hebrews chapter 10 on you. Amen? Listen, Paul says, if I tell you the truth, do I become your enemy? Can I tell you what Paul says? I'm telling you this. He's talking about it was when he's encouraging people to give. He's saying, I'm telling you this not for my account, but for your account. See, can I tell someone the truth? Listen to me. Let me make this clear. Let me make this perfectly, crystally clear. Crystally. That means really clear. Crystally clear. There's a day coming. There are people that you know right now, and they have the same mentality, and now they're not going to church nowhere. They're not serving God, and if you ask them if they're saved, they'll look you straight in the face and say, absolutely, how could you even dare think that I'm not saved? I love Jesus just like you love Jesus. Well, let me tell you what. You aren't going to be the one who judges on the day of judgment. And can I tell you what's going to really happen? Jesus isn't even going to judge. All Jesus is going to do is turn the light on. He is the light. And all he's going to do is expose what really is. That's all that's going to happen. Can I tell you what? I've got no other place better to be than here. I got no other place better than being here. Do we want more people to come? Do we want more people to come? Okay, then you come. Do we want more people to come Wednesday? Then you come on Wednesday. Do we want more people to be committed? Then you be committed. Oh, no, Pastor. Pastor, you set me up, man. I want more people to come, hey, listen. Read it yourself. For if we sin willfully. Can I tell you what? When you don't come to church, it's your choice. That's why I said willfully. That's what he's saying. Here. He's calling it a sin. Do you see this word for? You know what for is? It's connecting. He's connecting the whole thing. If I said, you know what? If you keep on, and I talk about speeding, I talk about running a yellow light, I talk about driving recklessly, and then if I said, you know what? For if you keep on doing this willfully, you're eventually going to get in an accident. How many know what I'd be talking about? He's talking about everything he just said before. He's calling this willful sinning. Because here's what he knows. He knows every single one of you. You say, Pastor, I don't know why you're getting on me. I'm here. Here's why. Because this mentality is prevalent in churches today. And the mentality isn't what it was 40 years ago. 40 years ago, people came to church and they circled their schedule around church. And the Bible says, here's what's going to happen, that as you forsake that, because some do and some don't, as the manner of some, there are incredible consequences to you. And Satan won't tell you those consequences, but God's word will. And he says, if you continue to willfully do this, there's going to be incredible consequence, even to the place. Now, this is where you guys are going to, you know, oh, yeah. Okay, you look at it. You try to make it out to be anything except that. No, I'm not talking about you, you know what, just coming up with your own theology. Looking at the Bible, using good hermeneutics, you tell me what it means. I'm telling you right now, you can't come up with anything except what's right there, because it's clear. And I'll prove it to you. First of all, the word proves it to you. But second of all, You and I know people that were as committed as we were who aren't serving the Lord anymore. You say, Pastor, are you saying they're going to hell? I don't know. Here's what I'm saying. Let me tell you what I'm saying. I'm saying what Hebrews says. If we sin willfully after we have received the knowledge of the truth, there no longer remains a sacrifice for sin. That's what I'm saying. That's all I'm saying. And what I'm saying is, you know probably 10 people right now who you hope are saved still. You hope they're saved. But in the back of your mind, you're thinking, their life doesn't show that they are. You say, Pastor, why do you share this? Because I know that difficult times are coming on us. And I'm telling you what, you got to lock in, man. We got to stay together. We've got to learn. We've got to be tougher than we've been. We've got to reprioritize what's really important. We've got to stop letting dances and concerts and you know what, and family and all this stuff get in our way. We've got to lead our hearts. We've got to lead our hearts. We've got to lead our families. We've got to not let people decide. We've got to influence people and not let them influence us.
I have a great scripture that is the icing on the cake for that message. This is in Psalms 119, and I'm going to begin reading at verse 65. You have dealt well with your servant, O Lord, according to your word. Teach me good judgment and knowledge, for I believe your commandments. Before I was afflicted, I went astray, but now I keep your word. You are good and you do good. Teach me your statutes. The proud have forged a lie against me, but I will keep your precepts with my whole heart. Their heart is as fat as grease, but I delight in your law. It is good for me that I have been afflicted, that I may learn your statutes. I don't know about you, but it has been impossible for me to live a life as a believer and not be in a situation consistently where I must choose to either keep his statutes or to compromise. So many, I sat on the front row just thinking about the importance of this being tough. And as the Lord took me to Psalm 119, that there is this decision to value that God is good and that he knows best and that our obedience to him will benefit us. I just thought of tons of situations from raising our children in trying to, it is not fun being the one who is always the naysayer. And yet there is much to naysay these days. And so if we don't teach our children in the way that they should go, what do we leave them? And do we think that as believers that we, because it's tough and parenting is not for cowards. Dr. Dobson wrote that book how long ago? Good grief, over 20 years ago. I didn't even have kids when he wrote that book. But I live the truth of that. Boy, he hit the nail on the head with that. We really have to trust God and know that God is good and His ways are best, and that we teach our children that. When we have some compromise in us, then as we live that compromise, we don't even get to walk in the full blessings of God. So our children don't even, not only do they not get the benefit of truth, but then they don't ever learn, you know what, the blessing that it is to serve God. I was thinking when we, you know what, when we got called here, we lost friends. Tough situations. You know what, we lost friends. We lost, you know, great opportunities that were in front of us, things that we desired. But that's in the moment. Now here we are 19 years later. No, not that long. How long? 16 years later?
17.
17 October. Years later. Ask me what I lost now. I didn't lose anything.
Amen. That's right.
I didn't lose anything. See, we think, you see, in that moment, we must choose God. We must know that His ways, that He is a good God, and that He has our best interests at heart.
Amen.
That He knows more than we know. And so it's nothing but sheer obedience to Him, no matter what. I didn't know the outcome at that moment. Do you remember? We spent 2 years, 2.5 years, our first 2.5 years here, kind of transforming the place, because it was not a pretty picture when we came. It was a mess, and it was a ton of work. And right when that all finished and everything was lovely, so it goes like those things you see on TV, like from trash to treasure. And at the treasure moment, an opposition came, and we had a choice. We could compromise God being in charge, which would possibly mean that we just spent the last two and a half years of our life, and now we're gone. We're leaving. Remember this?
Yeah.
I'll never forget. With pastor's office, I don't know how many, this church has been here, I think, over 50 years, but there was 50 years worth of paint on the doors. It had been painted who knows how many times. And so the very last room that we renovated was pastor's office. And when I did pastor's office, I remember stripping every door, all the paint off of it, because I wanted to make it, I wanted to stain it and make it nicer, you know, wood. But we didn't have the money to buy the new doors. So it was just a ton of work. And so there was a lot of love and a lot of care that went into pastor's office. Not that it didn't every other room, but that's my husband. So it was important to me. You know what? It was a gift to him to have put all that labor in. The desk, same thing, just sanded and stripped the desk. It was a mess, stains everywhere. And I'll never forget at this moment that we had to either be tough and stay true to God or compromise. We were in that office 2.5 years later. It was all done, and tears were just streaming down my eye, and I said, listen, I have not done this office for someone else to walk in here and become pastor of this church. But if that's what it means, if all we've done, if God has called us here that we would prepare this place and then we would leave, then so be it. Then that's what'll happen. Listen, this thing is in God's hands. He's the one who brought us here, and He will be the one. No one, who, if God is for us, who can be against us? And so if someone else comes here and enjoys this office, I would so much rather have that than to compromise the Word of God. When we came, we said, we will be who we are and no one else. That we will be true to God no matter what. And so that day closed. And here we are 16 years later, we're still here. And if you say, well, how did it happen? I don't even know. I mean, it was just God. It was a God thing. You know what I mean? It was God. It didn't make a lot of sense. But it was awesome. That was our own David and Goliath moment. But you never get to take down Goliath if you run and hide. Never.
That's right.
But you see, David didn't take Goliath down, did he?
That's right.
God did that for David.
Yeah.
And you never get to be David and know he was with me with the lion and he was with me with the bear. And this uncircumcised Philistine will be no different. If you cower and compromise, then you don't get to be David and have that moment. A victory. Amen?
Amen.
We need to toughen up and become way more true to God than we ever have been. Amen? Amen.
Hi, this is Pastor Drew in Hope Community Church. I just want to invite you to our church. We've got a great church. And one of the reasons why our church is so awesome is because we've got friendly people who care. They care for others. It's just a great atmosphere. If you haven't been here, let me just invite you. You know what? We're real close, right off the 605 freeway on Whittier. Just go to the webpage and find directions. We're so close to probably where you live. We just want to invite you. I can guarantee you that after you come to Hope, you're going to say, man, I'm so glad we went to that church. And we just want to invite you and tell you, hey, we look forward to seeing you.